Hi, I'm Kumi Taguchi. Tonight on Insight, who's getting lucky in the life after work lottery? How did you find the early days of retirement?
Confusing. I feel quite liberated. I don't see it as a negative thing.
The road ahead seemed too long. I couldn't understand what I would be doing.
And what did that mean for your super?
I lost $500,000.
I think for some of us, it's important to retire early enough that you can start a second life.
Thank you so much for being here. Michelle, welcome.
Hi,
thank you. You're 29. When are you aiming to be able to afford to retire?
So the goal is by 35.
By 35?
Yeah.
That's decades earlier than the average retirement age. Where did that come from?
So for me, it started when I was really young because I had a very sort of... it was a very niggling kind of stress about the idea of working my entire life and being chained to a desk until one day I could kind of just down tools and not work anymore. And hopefully the theory was that at that point I'd still be able-bodied enough to kind of and to actually enjoy a retirement. And that just never really sat right with me. My parents were very sort of typical middle-class people. And I just remember, like everyone, it was just a very status quo narrative about how people worked. And it wasn't necessarily inherently negative because my parents were passionate about what they did. They worked in the fields that they were passionate about. But I think that it was just like the lack of choice. It took me a long time to actually realise that it was about choice,
right,
not about work.
So what does the concept of retirement then mean to you?
It inherently and intrinsically means choice and flexibility over what I do with my time and my energy, how much time I spend with my son, how much time I spend with my family. So money not being a barrier to any of those choices I want to make.
Michelle, when you tell people about your plans to retire young, how do they react?
Mostly people are very interested. I think most of the criticism, it's that people that want to retire early are lazy. So there's a real stigma around laziness, but I find that really baffling, and I actually question how much value and contribution someone who is chained to a desk in a job they hate, you know, for 10 hours a day, commuting there an hour as well and then commuting home, can actually make to society when they are literally exhausted in the evenings and on the weekends and they're just resting just to try and catch up with some sort of semblance of feeling normal. But really, if you actually think about it, you're largely just lining the pockets of corporations for the most part. So really, what value are you actually creating?
We're going to talk a little bit more in a moment about how you're going to achieve that early retirement goal. Simon, welcome.
Hi.
You retired at 60.
Yes.
Had you always planned to stop work at that age?
No, it was an impulsive decision at the time. I thought I'd keep working until about 62, but things just rolled out that way. I was travelling a lot for work, spending a lot of time sitting in motel rooms on the bed watching TV at night. And I realised I was no longer sort of feeling involved with it, no longer enjoying it. So I was in a financial position where I knew I could retire, and spur of the moment, I just decided to retire, put in my resignation and do one more trip interstate before I quit.
Had you done some financial planning before this decision to retire?
No, not in the strict sense. I was sort of quite late discovering superannuation and the importance of it. So I started putting extra money into super when I realised how important it was and buying as much as I could.
Simon, you had an idea of what retirement might look like, but on this last work trip, something happened.
Something
what
did happen.
Was that something?
As my last trip to Canberra, I had a travel date from the internet. And I met Stephen.
And travel date.
And 11 years later, we're still together.
Wow.
So you're not supposed to fall in love at 60, but I did. And it threw retirement into a totally different light, because instead of being depressed about losing an identity. I gained this sort of whole new identity on one level, moving into a new relationship, starting a home together, starting new interests together. It was a really vibrant time as opposed to how most people see it.
Stephen, what was it like to meet someone who was sort of on the cusp of being a man of leisure?
I think it actually inspired me in many ways. We're so conditioned to work and to save and to see life through a very different lens. And so for me, it was, inspiration. So we've had lots of conversations in the early days about retirement and what would it mean for me? How do you prepare? So it's this transition rather than this on-off switch.
Stephen, you took the plunge at the end of 2019 and retired. What made you come to that decision?
Well, actually, I'd tried about 8 months before and failed.
Right.
So I was fortunate where I was working. They offered me a redundancy. Then after a few months, they called me and said, could I go back and consult? Did that. But what made me do it was I saw how well Simon lives his life. It was inspiring. My sister had died and... She was 57, 58, had aggressive cancer, and I suppose it made me think, what's it all about? It's one of those moments. So I think deep reflection, I thought, what the hell, what have we got to lose? And we've done everything to work very hard, so let's enjoy it. And it's been great.
Stephen, your first full year of retirement was spent in Melbourne in 2020. What impact did COVID have on your retirement plans?
The impact it had, we subscribed to Netflix, which never did. We had booked an apartment in Florence for 2 months and were to fly into Milan at the beginning of March.
Wow.
Clearly we didn't.
But we managed that by having every Friday night we'd get dressed up and have formal cocktails.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
And we had a group of people who would all share their photographs having cocktails. So it gave us an excuse to get dressed up, but it also made us feel we were part of still connecting with people. And that, I think, helped a lot, didn't it?
Oh, enormously.
Yeah. It sounds like you kind of have a very structured life, you know, structured sense of Friday night cocktails. Mm-hmm. Is that how you kind of intended to approach that transition to retirement?
I suppose it was, because we do believe that you have to have a routine, you have to be structured. We have regular gym times we go to, we have hobbies we go to. We deliberately decided there were things we do separately as well as together, because we'd probably fight like anything if we were doing, you know, some competitive things.
Yeah. To both of you, I guess, you know, how do you feel about entering this stage of life, you know, becoming an official senior, as they say?
Actually, do you mind if I call it? I was excited because in Melbourne, in Victoria, when you turn 60, you get a seniors card, and that gives me a discount on the tram to go see my personal trainer. So I thought that was quite a good thing to get. I feel quite liberated. I don't see it as a negative thing.
I think many people do, and I think you have to actually take a deep breath and say, I can't say I don't like older people. I am an older person. I'm one of them. And I have to walk in through the door to a gym class where everybody's going to be over 60 and none of us are going to look great and we'll do it together. I actually find that women seem to make that adjustment better than men. The gym classes, we go to the lounge classes, your bridge class, they're nearly all 90% women.
Right.
And not many men.
You both chose and planned for your retirement, that choice, did that have an impact on how you felt about the transition out of work, that you'd decided this?
I suppose I never thought what I did for a living defined who I was.
Right.
Your question about being old is interesting, though, because I've done about 10 short films recently, and the characters I get are always dead, dying or have dementia. That seems to be the definition. They rarely have names in the script. They're just creaky old man or grandfather. There's no concept that in the broader community that was something other than just old people.
Wow.
And while I've worked with some fantastic people, I'd love to see a script where I wasn't going to die at the end.
Yeah, wouldn't that be nice? Gina, welcome. Nice to meet you. You're 61.
I am.
You were considering joining your husband, David, in retirement last year. What was that going to look like?
Well, in the past, we'd done a lot of travel and we were certainly going to do some more extensive travel last year.
How much planning had you done to secure your life after work?
Lots of money into super, salary sacrificed. I've always worked. I've worked while I've gone to uni. I've worked while my children have been little. So done all those sacrifices. And coming from a migrant family, that's what you do. You work hard to get somewhere, you know, and to build up that nest egg.
Gina, last September you were reading the Sunday papers.
Yes.
And you realised that the retirement you had imagined might not be possible.
Correct.
What did you discover that day?
Well, we discovered, much to our surprise, that the company that we were with, which was a very, very big company, superannuation company, had been taken to court by ASIC. We looked at our statements and things like that, and we had wondered why our superannuation was not making any money for probably nearly 4 years.
Right.
It was going backwards, as a matter of fact, and we had questioned that on several occasions with our advisors, and only to be placated by saying, oh, it'll come good, it'll come good. Mm. Anyway, ASIC had finally caught up with them and taken them to court.
And what did that mean for your super?
I lost $500,000.
Half a million.
Correct.
Gina, what was that moment like when you realised that and read the papers?
Terrible. They hadn't had the decency to tell us that that was the case.
David, you're Gina's husband. What was that moment like for you, realising that $500,000 was gone?
It was life-changing, really. Not totally, in that we're not sort of on the street. Mm. And in our situation, I'm not working. I haven't worked for a number of years. Gina's only working part-time. There is no way we could actually recoup that through work.
Yes. Gina, where does this leave your retirement plans?
Very different. As a consequence of that, I almost had a nervous breakdown, you might say. Mm. I got quite ill. I got cancer. I had a number of other health issues. I was extremely stressed. To the point where my specialists were saying, something must have brought this on. Have you had a stressful situation? Well, yes, I have. So I continue to work, albeit in a very sort of a junior role now. I held quite senior roles in the past and would have been able to make up that money had I still been in the workforce in those sort of senior roles. However, now I don't have that opportunity, and with my health situation, I have far less opportunity to make that up.
What has that mental shift been like for you, going from this idea of I can retire when I want to now I can't afford to retire?
Big. It's huge. It's like I don't have a choice anymore. Mm. I suppose that choice has been taken away from me. It's about the trust that we placed in our financial advisors, that they let us down. Mm.
And David, you've been retired for 9 years.
Yeah.
So you're used to that retirement lifestyle. How has this changed your life?
It's changed in that what we would like to have done or to be doing in the future, we may not be able to do. And the way we will do it will be different.
Gina, how are you feeling now?
Yeah, how do I feel? I feel kind of useless. I feel all the work that I've done has sort of come to nothing. It's just been taken away from me and stolen from me.
Thank you. Kate, hi. Welcome. Lovely to meet you.
You too.
You were planning on a sea change for your retirement, and you started that process when you were 62. What was your plan then?
Well, it was interesting because I was in full-time employment. I worked at a major hospital for about 9 years in medical admin, and I lost that job. And I'd previously been up to Noosa. I'm a triathlete. I do a lot of sport. And Noosa's triathlon haven. I fell in love with Noosa. I thought, this would be a nice place to retire, you know, the sea change thing. And then when I lost my job, I got a bit of a payout, and I thought, right, this is it. This is the time. So I packed everything up, took Millie, my cat, rented my place out, and went up to Noosa for a year. And I spent 6 months there. And in that 6 months, I didn't get one day's work, not one. And I ended up going into a clinical depression. And I remember I was on Noosa Beach at Christmas Day. I lay on my back and I just burst into tears. I can still feel it. I just thought, what has happened? What have I done? Because my super was just going out the window because I didn't have any work. I went back to Sydney for my birthday to catch up with some friends, and I started applying for work in Sydney. And I actually immediately started getting interviews. Very strange.
Did you find work?
Yes, I got a part-time job, mat leave, in another hospital. I had to sell my little unit because I've lost over about 60 grand. I don't even have 500,000, never had that much money. But it was, 50 grand out of my super. So I only had like 20 left.
Wow.
And I thought if I stay in my unit, I'm going to be living in poverty like a lot of single women do. I'm going to own this property and I can't do anything. The pension won't do it.
What options were then left for your retirement at that stage?
Well, I got part-time job, then it became going with an agency, then it became casual, then it became 3 days a week, then it became 2 days a week, and then I wasn't getting the work. And so I had to make a decision. I thought, well, if I sell, where am I going to go? So I went into, the over 55s retirement village, which it's been about 4 years now, and I'm kind of just sort of accepting it because it's a whole different life. If I had the money, I'd be out of there in a shot. I'm a bit out of the box. I'm a lesbian. I do a lot of fitness. And I guess what I've seen is my future. I've seen how people age. Mm. And I'm learning how not to age.
Kate, why do you think you couldn't get work in Noosa?
There were two. I actually got two jobs with different cardiologists. Both said yes, you'll get the job. One, the person decided not to leave. The other one said you've got the job, and then they rang me the next day and they said, "Oh well, we're actually going to take on a student because I have to pay them less." Right.
How do you feel older people are treated when they're looking for work?
Well, my experience was. And I'm very competent. I don't say I'm a genius, but I was very competent, very good organiser at what I did. And to be told we're getting a student, they just could get somebody that was cheaper. So now I feel if you've got a problem with my sexuality, it's your problem. So if you've got a problem with my age, it's your problem. That's the attitude I need to take. Otherwise, I'll just sink, because of the ageism that's kind of in society.
David, does this idea of choosing when you're able to retire sort of resonate with you?
It does. I look forward to retiring and I was ready to retire. But if you want, like Kate, if you wanted to go back to work and you apply for jobs, you don't want to work at the level you were working previously, to be told you're overqualified, and that's a polite way of saying you're too old, after a while, just... it takes the wind right out of your sails. It damages your self-confidence. And I think it's such a stupid response. Because why would you hire a student as opposed to someone who's experienced in what they do and have got years of experience when you're paying the same amount of money? At our stage in life, we're not looking at progression. We're just looking at maintaining a lifestyle, generating an interest, keeping the mind alert, and so it gets very demoralising when you're told you're overqualified.
Michael, hi. You've researched people's transition into retirement. Does being in control of that choice make a difference?
It makes a very big difference because there are so many dimensions to lack of control when you're retiring. For example, a lot of people want to retire all their debt. Now, if that planned ability to sort of work along to that before you retire is taken from you, then that's a major problem. The other area, though, is that it's such a big life transition, retirement, and people need the time to prepare. They need to think about it, imagine a transition up in the mind as well as financially. And that can be, if that's taken away from you, well, it's not a good outcome.
If there's a sense of sort of rejection, ageism, you're not useful anymore, can that have an impact on mental health as well?
Yes, it can. What we found in the research was that people tended to, when they're losing their identity and when they're not able to, I guess, say that I am a such and such or I work as a such and such, that's when things were starting to go wrong.
Michael, do you think most people are prepared for this stage of life?
If you speak to most people just before they retire, what they'll say to you is, look, we're pretty sure we're going to be right financially. We've got reasonable health. Therefore, what could possibly go wrong?
Right.
And it's not until you actually do retire and go through, you know, the honeymoon period of retirement, if you like, that you suddenly wake up one day and think, well, hang on, there's got to be more to life than just recreational activities such as golf or fishing. You know, there's going to come a time when they're not enough.
We're not well off, but we're comfortably enough off for what we want to do.
Just living on the age pension alone is enormously difficult.
Mm. I'm actually very grateful that I'm modestly comfortable.
John, you're 69, you retired 6 years ago. How did you find the early days of retirement?
Confusing.
Right.
And, for example, I'd be in my study mid-afternoon because I was still thinking about getting a job at that stage. The phone might ring and one of my so-called friends would say, oh, John, it's 3 o'clock, it's Monday afternoon. I hope I didn't wake you from your afternoon nap.
Oh, really?
And that was their idea of an Australian joke. But as with all jokes, there was a kernel of truth.
Truth.
I thought it was the time of life to try something different. And I'd done some training in coaching and counselling that maybe if I thought about retirement enough, I could help other people with the emotional aspect of retirement that we've been talking about.
Did that then turn into a new job for you?
I work part-time as a retirement coach. It's exactly that job where you assist people to make that emotional transition across the bridge into retirement.
John, at what stage do you usually get a phone call from people saying, hey, I need some help here?
The sweet spot is when they're on the verge of retirement. So they're starting to wind down from work. They're vaguely aware that things will change when they retire. And this was something I wasn't aware of myself. I learned it the hard way. There's actually a Japanese word for this. It's ikigai.
I'm always looking for my ikigai.
Yeah. Yes. And pardon me if my translation is poor, but I think it means reason to get out of bed in the morning.
Yeah, that's it.
Otherwise known as meaning or purpose. Can be extremely hard.
Robin.
Yes.
You retired from managing a bank you'd worked at for 27 years.
Yep.
This was at 55 years old.
Yep.
What were you looking forward to?
Well, I guess I had about 6 months to think about my impending retirement, and I was looking towards all those normal retirement related things.
So what did those first 12 months look like?
Got lots of things done in the house, renovating, and just general relaxing.
How did you feel? Did you miss that sense of sort of identity, that sense of interaction with others?
Well, I think this is it. I've just realised that I went through the honeymoon period. Oh. Got to the end of that and thought, hang on a minute, this is quite different to what I thought it would be.
Right.
When I looked into the future, retirement for me seemed to be dull, silent, and I realised I was missing that interaction that I was having in the workplace. The road ahead seemed too long. I couldn't understand what I would be doing for all those years ahead of me. And I just needed more structure or more routine in my life.
Michael, what are people's expectations of that first year after work and that transition period?
Yes, the honeymoon period, and I mean, I'm using that term because it is actually in the retirement literature. It is usually around a year, up to a year. And what happens is that if you look at the word recreational, it comes from, you know, create. It's where people are moving away from a stressful environment and doing something to nurture themselves, to recreate themselves. But if all you've got is that, if you haven't got a sense of purpose, if you haven't got structure in your life, then the recreation is not enough. And when you look at the aspects of work, even if you don't like your job and even if you don't like the company you're working for, there are still things like structure. You get up at a certain time and go to work. There are people at the workplace that you'll like, so there's social activity there. There's status if you've got some sort of, you're a manager. There's identity. There's a feeling of contributing. Mm-hmm. Now, all those things, if you think that knocking a little white ball around a golf course is going to replace all of those, then obviously it's not.
Robin, given how you felt about that 12 months, what did you then decide to do?
Quite quickly, actually. I thought I was going to study. So I enrolled in a 3-year degree course at university. Wow. I started a registered nurse degree. I had to work hard, but it was good, interesting, huge, big learning curve, and emerged as a registered nurse.
At what age?
I would have been 58.
Congratulations, that's fantastic.
Thank you.
Thank you, Robin. Judy, hi.
Hi.
You were 50 when you retired from a career in retail and medical administration. Was that by choice?
No, not at all. I basically had to medically retire, diagnosed with chronic fatigue syndrome at age 36, and struggled through. And it was a real battle and a real effort to stay at work. And then suddenly it was all gone.
Had you enjoyed your career?
Loved it. Every minute of my career, I've enjoyed everything I've ever done.
How did you respond to life without work in those early days?
Oh, just lots of anger and resentment, like punching holes in walls, smashing plates. It was just not very pleasant.
Do you think that's because the choice was taken away from you?
Absolutely, absolutely. Maybe I could cope if I was working in an area I didn't like, but I'm kind of a helper and I've always kind of worked in those industries, and not having that outlet anymore took a long time to find me.
Judy, what did that sort of loss of identity, that loss of being a helper, feel like to you?
It's interesting. I never lost confidence in my skills, but not being productive is really difficult and still is today. But I did do volunteering, some volunteering, but that sort of became too much for me as well.
And I can imagine your job was very social, you're interacting with a lot of people. Did that kind of sort of eliminate from your life as well?
Yes, and it's actually progressed. I'll be 75 shortly, so I've been retired nearly 25 years, and I find myself more and more isolated, partly because of the consequences of an illness. And I had no superannuation. It had only been mandated 2 or 3 years beforehand. And I was also very angry because I ended up in government housing. I'd never planned to be in government housing, but once I got there, I was pretty resentful about the whole issue.
Judy, how do you feel now, this sense of sort of validation, having a purpose? Do you feel sort of seen as a human being in this society?
Yeah, no. Sometimes I just say I'm invisible. And I think a lot of women become invisible once they're about 60 anyway. So, yeah, life's pretty isolating and boring right now.
Kate, was your sense of identity impacted by leaving work?
Not at all, and it's been really interesting listening to the conversation and shared experiences, because what I heard was this identity, you know, this big identity with work. And I've been very eclectic in my work and my careers, lots of different careers. So my one career I had in social work in England, when that went, I absolutely fell apart. But I learnt from that never to put my eggs in one basket again. It was a very hard lesson. So I never lost, as you were saying, I'm just doing other things. I do volunteer work. I'm about giving more than just taking, if that makes sense. Sometimes I feel like I haven't actually stopped working because I'm doing more now than I was when I was working. I'm just not getting paid for it.
Okay. Stephen, how do people respond to you when you say, I'm retired?
There's a pause in their response often, and I think it's an awkwardness. And I try to bridge that by saying, you know, I have so many choices now. But the response is, well, what did you do?
Yeah.
And is this tied up in identity that your job is who you are? And it's much broader than that. And I think if you can get rid of the ego about what your job is not you, that helps enormously.
Simon?
Other people, I don't necessarily say I'm retired, I say, oh, I write a fashion column for a magazine called Bold But Not Old. Mm-hmm. You know, tips for older people would be fantastic. I tell them the other stuff I do rather than say, oh, I'm not in paid employment, because there's a stigma around being retired.
John, do we need to replace that status and work identity? Like, should we replace it or should we look at it in a different way?
Well, I think it's natural because most of us who have a working life have one that lasts for four decades. That's a long time. And it does take a period to detach yourself from the meaning that's embedded in your working life. But yes, I think that it's a really good idea at that age to detach yourself from the meaning that was there with your working life and think ahead to how to recreate yourself in a new environment.
Marg, you're John's partner of 17 years. You're on the cusp of retirement. Mm. How are you planning to navigate this new stage of your relationship?
Well, I tell you, keeping up with John is going to be a bit hard, so I'm kind of leaving that one aside. But so I think with John and I together, it's about planning and thinking about, well, what do you actually want to do together? Because we've got a lot of separate interests, which is great, and I think that's important. But we did try golf. Oh, my God. we had golf lessons, and truly, even the pro went, I don't think you two are ready yet to go out onto the... So that's just sitting on the side. But we are in a book club together, which is fun. And we always make sure we have at least one meal a day together.
So you've clearly had sort of conversation about how this next phase of your life will work. You'll be spending more time at home together, I presume. Are you looking at how you might live your home life, given that you've got these different kind of spheres?
And we had to sell the apartment that we'd bought to move into because, guess what, it's not big enough.
Right. Because you're both at home.
Yeah, we're both at home. And COVID taught us that we both still really need an office, which is, a bedroom. And mine's currently on the dining room table. And every time someone comes over, you've got to move everything. So yeah, we're pretty... Yeah, it's good fun, actually. Enjoying it. I'm sad to hear that other people are not so much. I feel very privileged. We've had a very privileged life. I mean, coaching this business is my fifth career. So... you don't have to just do one to pretty well everybody else.
Michael, can retirement be a tricky time for couples?
Yes, it can be. You would be surprised at the number of women that I heard say when I was doing this research, I married him for life but not for lunch.
Oh, right.
And who talk about an underfoot husband following them around, annoying the hell out of them. And one of the problems, I mean, it just comes down to communication, but unfortunately... we tend to keep our worst style of communication, our most dysfunctional communication, for the people we're closest to, because nobody else would put up with it for a start. I think a lot of those problems disappear, though, with purposeful activity.
Right.
Particularly where each person has got their own purposeful activities. Sure, it's good to have some in common, but where you're not sitting around bored, looking for trouble, looking for problems with each other, where you've got your own life and you're engaged and involved.
Stephen, did you and Simon talk much about how to manage this dynamic of both having more free time?
COVID was actually quite good for us in some ways, because being shut in
in Melbourne for such a long period of time, we got used to the fact that Stephen would go in one room and play bridge and I go in the other room and do Duolingo. And we might spend like an hour and a half away from each other, then meet up for coffee or something. And we weren't sort of constantly doing everything together. You've got to have some things you decide to do together and some things that you definitely do quite separate and you have your own interests away from your partner so that you're not constantly on top of each other.
Kate, you're single.
Yes.
Have there been any challenges staying sort of socially connected without the structures of work and colleagues?
I've always been someone that's wanting to be engaged, so I've never felt isolated in that sense. I've been very political for a long time. I was doing volunteer work anyway, like I'm a 78er, so I'm from the first Mardi Gras, and so I've been very involved in the gay and lesbian community for many, many years. I feel the need to be engaged, but then I can go back to Rosie, my little cat, and I can close the door and I can have my own little time, my own quiet time, and watch Netflix and whatever, read trashy
novels. SBS On Demand.
Yes. Exactly. I'd do all of that.
Can I just jump in there and say it's absolutely essential, I think, for all of us that we engage with our community in as many ways as we can, because that's really what keeps you vibrant and gives you a meaning to get up every day. Mm. It's absolutely essential.
Mm. Michael, from your research, what have you found have been issues for single people as they retire, as opposed to couples?
People retire as singles for a whole range of reasons. Sometimes it's just because they've always been single. Other times they might have lost their partner through death or divorce. So, you know, a lot of people arrive as singles in retirement. I think what we're also talking about is loneliness. And people who are living by themselves really need to either reach out to family and friends, or if that's not possible, to get involved in activities where they're mixing with other people.
Kate, your time in Noosa ate into your savings. Mm. Where are you at now financially, if you're willing to share
something? That's fine. So it was almost bittersweet. Because I was forced to sell my unit and I did have a little bit of super, and because it compounds, I'm actually better off than I ever thought I would be, in the sense that I'm not rich, I'm not poor. Had that not happened, where I was in a state of almost heading towards poverty and then selling my unit, understanding to me it was just concrete, right? It's just walls, that I was more than just that home that everyone struggles to hang on to. I'm going to another place where it's more concrete and I'm in a very small box, but I've made that my home. So I'm actually very grateful that I'm modestly comfortable, and I don't desire to be anything but modestly and comfortable.
And do you see that money lasting for you?
No. Well, then that is the thing. There's X amount, and there's a certain amount where I realise, and I'm sort of with the COVID, we all lost money in super. Like one day there was 25 grand less than there was the day before. So all of that's happened and it's going up and down. But I look at it every month and I think, OK, when it gets to that particular point, but I'm trying to be fiscally responsible so that I don't get into the same trap where all I've got is my pension. Because even living there, I see what happens to people who've just got the pension and they don't do a lot because they financially don't have the money to do a lot.
I'd like to sort of throw it open, you know, is money something that you worry about, Simon, Stephen? Looking ahead?
Not really. We're told our super will last as long as we do. Yeah. That's a bit of gruesome, putting it that way. So, no, it's not really a factor for us. We're not well off, but we're comfortably enough off for what we want to do.
Mm. Judy?
So I just want to pass on that comment about just living on the age pension alone is enormously difficult. I guess I'm fortunate. I've got a bit of a half full glass mentality, so I'm very grateful for the pension and I'm very grateful for living in housing because I can afford not to have to share. And when you have chronic fatigue syndrome and trying to share with anybody is almost impossible. So yeah, I'm very frugal. Do a lot of secondhand shopping. I mean, you do pick up some bargains, you know.
Great.
I find fresh fruit and veggies have gone up a little bit in price. I do run a car, which is challenging, but it's my legs. I can't even really walk up the road to get the bus. So a car is very important for me.
Gina.
I now have to think about my medical issues and how much I'm going to have to put aside for that, my living in the future, whether I'm going to go into that retirement place or whether I'm going to be staying at home. I would have liked to have helped my children with securing sort of properties and things like that, just help them along a bit, but I haven't been able to do that.
When things don't go to plan, Michael, is there a way people can regain control of a situation?
Yeah, yes, there is. And I've mentioned before this business about purposeful activities. There's where you actually produce something. It might be something through woodwork, it might be art, it might be writing. Then there's the category of either paid or unpaid work, so volunteering. And of course, to volunteer, you need a certain income too. If your income is the age pension and nothing else, sometimes you really can't even afford to volunteer because you've got to get to places, you've got to possibly have some sort of uniform or whatever. Yeah. Mm. And then the last area, the third area that comprises a purposeful activity, is where you get involved in self-development, doing some courses. And I think you might have taken it to a ridiculous level by going back to university from being a bank manager, I think, and into nursing. And that's a magnificent example.
You can't live a champagne caviar lifestyle. And at the moment, we're investing about 75% of our take-home incomes, and we are looking at retirement by 35.
Michelle, you want to exit the 9-to-5 life by the time you're 35. Mm-hmm. How are you planning to do that?
So I follow the FIRE methodology, which stands for Financial Independence, Retire Early. There's a few ways to do it, but a very high-level overview is that you effectively save as much as you possibly can, and you invest it into a low risk and moderate returns kind of safe investment vehicles, and you try to live off of the return that's generated from that principal amount, which becomes your passive income, so it's income that you don't have to work for, and try not to touch that principal amount. And you try and make it as diversified as possible so that it can withstand, you know, major market and economic events.
Michelle, you started saving and investing at 21 years old. How frugal do you need to be to make this vision work?
There's certainly an element of cutting down your spending. You can't live a champagne caviar lifestyle. But my husband and I are pretty happy, and in fact, I think we're happier than we've actually ever been. And so, although we were kind of cutting down on those expenses and minimalising them, our happiness shot up because all of a sudden we were spending money on things that made us really happy and made us feel really fulfilled.
Do you mind me asking how much you both live on a year?
The amount that we're happy to live off of in our retirement will sit around the $80,000 mark. And at the moment we're investing about 75% of our take-home incomes.
Are you on track to achieve that financial independence that you would like to by 35?
Yeah. I had a baby 18 months ago, so that did slow us down a little bit. But we've kind of regulated that now. We're back on track and we are looking at retirement by 35. Well, my husband's 9 years older, so for him, he'll be 44, I think.
OK. Once you do hit that mark, Michelle, what do you think your attitude to work will be?
10 years ago, I would have said, oh, as soon as I retire, I'm downing tools, I'm not working another day in my life. And that's actually evolved and that's changed over time. I think, because I have a business now and I really enjoy what I do, so I think that we still want to work, but we want to work on our own terms and on things that really bring us joy, irrespective or not of whether they make money.
Kate, what do you think about this idea of going without quite a lot in your younger years?
Well, I did by default through life experience. You know, if I'd had my time again, I probably would have saved more, but life got in the way. But I also would think that I wouldn't want to focus on just doing that in order to make my life a lot easier. I think we need to enjoy life at whatever stage we're at. So there's planning, but there's not becoming it being the complete focus, because things can happen.
I don't actually focus on money that much. I don't really think about it, to be honest with you. It's a lot of it's just muscle memory now. It's kind of like automated. So for me, it just gives me more of a safety buffer. I have worked up until this point to have money put away that I can tap into if I need to, versus not having it there at all.
Robin, far from retiring, you're now nearly 69 and you're still working.
I do, yes, yes. So once I got through my university degree, I thought that was it. But I managed to get a job relatively easily. I didn't feel there was any age discrimination in that employment. Worked very happily for quite a big public hospital for about 4 years. And I thought, I'm going to retire again. That only lasted another couple of months. And I was offered a job in a local nursing home. And that's where I work now. And I've been doing that, I suppose, for about 4 years now. And I work there on a casual basis, so I can please myself really when I go to work. I still get so much out of it. I can't see any point in giving it up totally if I'm still enjoying it as much as I do.
What do your family and friends say?
My family seems to find it all okay. I mean, I've been probably caused a bit of inconvenience from time to time because I haven't been available to pick kids up from school or babysit, etc. But, you know, that's got over those hurdles quite easily.
Marg, you're still working in your early 70s. What do your friends think?
I think they're all quite... I mean, all the women that... my first career was physiotherapy, and that was 50 years ago. And they have all retired, so I don't mind. I don't mind what they think, actually. But mostly they're happy. I relate to the grandchildren comment. I get into trouble sometimes for not being as available as I... But it was very clear that wasn't going to be how I want to spend my retirement.
Right.
And that was fine.
Robin, are you considering retirement anytime soon, given that you've tried it before? Or do you see an end point?
I do talk about it. There's sort of a little bit of subtle pressure there that, you know, maybe it is time you retired. I'm still able to do the work. I'm still quite, you know, relatively agile and fit. If I could, I'd probably just keep working until I got to that point where I thought, this is it, I'm finished, but I'm not at that point yet, and I'm just not sure when that's going to occur.
Mm. Michael, how important is that purpose in retirement?
Well, it's after health and having enough money, it's the next one, I believe. It's critically important. And it's the difference between feeling engaged and involved and wallowing.
Judy, how did you find adjusting to this new stage?
It's acceptance. I have no way of changing how I am and what's occurring in my life. So I have no control over that, other than endeavouring to keep myself as healthy as possible and to eat good, healthy food, to stay away from stressful situations, and you just manage.
Gina, how do you feel about the prospect of life after work?
Daunting, actually, for me.
Daunting in what way?
Daunting because of my health issues, it's going to preclude me from doing a number of things. Not only that, it's the finance issues, which will also preclude me from doing the things that I was hoping to do.
David, how did you find purpose in life after work?
Well, I had lots of activities to do. So while I really resent the comments on golf, I enjoy golf.
It's okay, you can enjoy golf.
So, but, you know, I like keeping physically active. You know, I cycle a couple times a week and do coffee with friends and play the odd game of golf.
A lot of golf.
There's lots of stuff out there to do. It's just whether you bother to find it or not.
Stephen, what did you learn from watching Simon make his transition from work to retirement?
I think I learned it's okay not to have to be doing something all the time. And Simon, yeah, showed me, like, it's a really great life too.
I think for some of us, it's important to retire early enough that you can start a second life.
Yeah.
I think rather than some people I know who are still working until their health packs up and things, you think that they're not going to be able to take advantage of retirement.
Kate, are you happy in retirement now?
Oh, my oath I am. When I came back from this huge trip, it really changed me. And I just thought, you know what, I've always wanted to play a musical instrument, which I gave up when I was young, like a lot of us. So I picked what I thought was the easiest, which is a ukulele. And I have a particularly magical teacher. And it's completely changed my life. But I have to practice, right? So it's like discipline again. But it's just taking on something new and you find out, oh, my God, there's something I didn't know about myself. So I'm very happy.
And, John, you're playing the piano, I think.
Badly, yes.
Yeah. Badly, that's fine. Michael, you play the clarinet?
Yes.
So it looks like we can have a jam session in here after the show. Thank you so much. This is all we have time for tonight. I cannot thank you enough for your time here today. Golf is fine. We've learnt that today as well.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you, too, for joining us.